HarperCollins presents Harry Styles, The Making of a Modern Man by Sean Smith. Read by Luke de Belder.
First impressions. It wasn't the eye-catching cover of Vogue that did it for me. It wasn't the envy-making cavorting with beautiful people on an idyllic, sun-kissed Malibu beach for the video of Watermelon Sugar. It wasn't two number one albums or his role in Dunkirk. No. What triggered a fascination with Harry Styles and made me want to write a book about him were just a few words from the actor and director Olivia Wilde, who described him as very modern, and observed, "I hope that this brand of confidence as a male that Harry has, truly devoid of any traces of toxic masculinity, is indicative of his generation and therefore the future of the world." Wow. That's quite an endorsement of a man who just 10 years earlier had done his best to impress Simon Cowell with a version of Stevie Wonder's sentimental chestnut, Isn't She Lovely? Did he deserve such praise from Olivia, I wonder? Like 15 million others, I had watched the entire 7th series of The X Factor in the days when it was compulsory Saturday night viewing. You literally weren't part of the Sunday conversation if you hadn't seen Matt, Rebecca, Cher, and the boys from One Direction battle it out every week to stay in the competition. The five members of One Direction had sparkle and youthful exuberance, but I had no idea they were going to rule the pop world in such a short space of time. The stars aligned for them. The world was ready for a new boy band. They had a brilliant team looking after them day to day, and they had the unswerving support of the corporate boardroom where careers were made or broken. The boys were only together for 5 intense, mad years, becoming multi-millionaires, before going on indefinite hiatus in December 2015. With a few exceptions, 5 years seems to be the average lifespan of a boy or girl band, especially one put together by a third party. That was true of Take That and the Spice Girls, for example. Zayn Malik had left One Direction before the official hiatus, which was a nice way of describing a full stop. Harry, though, was already looking different from the others. He had longer, rock star hair and an eye for the fashionable and flamboyant. But nice hair and the ability to look good in a Gucci suit did not make him modern. My task in this book is to see if the description of Harry Styles as a modern man is justified. Is Olivia right, or is referencing toxic masculinity just a neat soundbite? You don't just arrive ready-made as a beacon of the present and future. So who are the friends, the role models, and the influences that have helped Harry on his journey? And what does it actually mean to be modern anyway? These are the questions I hope to answer in a serious look at a superstar. Harry Styles, The Making of a Modern Man. See you on the other side. Part 1. Finding Direction. Chapter 1. Dressing Up. Harry Styles was nearly born in the back of a car. His dad, Des, confessed that he and his heavily pregnant wife, Anne, only just made it to the Alexandra Hospital in Redditch before their son was on his way. It was a 20-mile dash up the A46 in Worcestershire from their home in Evesham. There wasn't even time to call the midwife. Instead, Harry Edward Styles said hello to the world at 2 a.m. on the 1st of February, 1994. There's a memorial statue in Redditch that honours a very famous name in world music. But it's not Harry. Instead, pride of place in the town centre belongs to John Bonham, the legendary drummer with Led Zeppelin. The local papers and media always refer to Harry as Redditch-born whenever the more recent superstar does anything noteworthy. But in reality, he has no connection with the town half an hour south of Birmingham, other than noting it as his place of birth on the official paperwork. A month after his second birthday, the Stiles family moved. Des and Anne sold the three-bedroom, semi-detached house in St. Philip's Drive, Evesham, an estate close to the main road, and relocated 100 miles north to rural Cheshire. They were a family of four. Harry had an elder sister, Gemma, who was three when he was born. They settled into a spacious, four-bedroom house in Chestnut Drive, Holmes Chapel, a large village that enjoyed a rural atmosphere despite being close to the motorway, and an easy 20-mile commute into Manchester. The town of Crewe was even closer, just 8 miles south. If there is going to be a statue of Harry Stiles in the future, then it should be in Holmes Chapel, probably in the main square near St. Luke's Church, or there's plenty of room outside his local secondary school in Selkirk Drive. Harry once said that nothing much happened in Holmes Chapel. That may be true, but it's not a sleepy village, and these days it is a bustling place, more like a small town than the gentle setting for an Agatha Christie whodunit or an episode of Midsummer Murders. The proximity to Manchester was ideal for Harry's dad, who was a committed supporter of Manchester United. And these were the best of times for the club, enjoying the glory years of Alex Ferguson and a first team that included Eric Cantona, Roy Keane, Paul Scholes, and David Beckham. There was always plenty of football memorabilia dotted around the Stiles house. At the time, Des, who was 10 years older than his then 28-year-old wife, worked in financial services as an operational manager for HFC Bank, primarily responsible for arranging loans and credit. Anne had her hands full with two young children. They could scarcely have been more different. Harry's elder sister was the quiet, studious one, an A-grade student throughout school who found the academic side of things much easier than standing up in front of the class, and could only look on a little jealously as her cheeky and precociously charismatic kid brother sailed through life. Harry did secure an A once for his very first English essay, and he was proud of his achievement. But perhaps the top mark lived long in his memory, because it was all downhill from there, and he never matched it. He was always the boy getting told off by the teacher for chatting away to his friends at the back of the class. His first preschool nursery was called, sweetly, Happy Days, and it was just 2 minutes' walk from their detached house in Chestnut Drive, a smart new build with a large garden for their dog, Max, to patrol. He was a cross between a border collie and a lurcher, who could sometimes look a bit fierce, but wasn't. And he loved the children to bits. Gemma had chosen him from a litter because he was the outsider, the only puppy who was not pure black. Ironically, Harry's very first word was not dog, but cat. Anne had driven the children to visit their grandparents, Brian and Mary Selly, in Hampshire. As they were walking up the path to the front door, the family feline appeared. Little Harry pointed and declared, "Cat!" which made everyone's day. When he was old enough, Harry joined his sister round the corner at the Hermitage Primary School. As was usual on these occasions, Mum came too, to make sure her five-year-old was going to be all right. She sat in the class for an hour or so, before slipping away. Harry may have been a bit of a mummy's boy, as Anne has always affectionately said, but she didn't leave a child weeping and wailing for his mother. He settled down to enjoy the day until she was back to walk him and Gemma home. From a young age, Harry was one of the boys and one of the girls. He never seemed limited by gender stereotyping, or, as he memorably put it, "I wasn't one of those boys who thought girls were smelly." Just to prove it, he gave one little girl, Phoebe, a teddy bear as a present when they were six. Right from the start, Harry was an enthusiastic performer in the school plays. Confident enough, it seemed, to get up on stage and sing, whatever embarrassing costume he had to wear. For the Christmas musical in December 2000, he played the title role of Barney, a church mouse. He sported a pair of Gemma's grey tights, a headband with oversized ears sticking out the top, and a long string tail. Looking back on his starring role, age six, he observed, "I like to think I was a good mouse." Often, enthusiastic mums can light the fire for their children, perhaps taking them to dance classes or booking piano lessons before they could barely walk. Anne loved playing dressing-up games with her children, painstakingly making elaborate papier-mâché outfits, including one that featured Harry as the World Cup. He also had a 101 Dalmatians outfit, which was a particular favourite and the one he wore all the time around the house. Anne explained, "I was always a big fan of doing fancy dress when my children were small, which Gemma hated, but Harry always embraced." Harry would carry his love of dressing up into adulthood, and in his now famous Vogue interview in 2020, he acknowledged, "There's so much joy to be had in playing with clothes. I've never thought too much about what it means, it just becomes this extended part of creating something." In the primary school favourite Chitty Chitty Bang Bang, he played Buzz Lightyear, who obviously did not feature in the original musical. In his school's adaptation, the children hid from the scary child catcher in a toy store where Buzz and Woody from Toy Story were living. Harry also played the Pharaoh in a production of Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. The character's big number is Song of the King, and he delivered it as if Elvis Presley had been transported back to biblical times. The first pop song that Harry learned all the words to was Girl of My Best Friend, a number that The King originally recorded for his 1960 UK number one album, Elvis Is Back. The track was one of his dad's favourites. None of the family was especially musical, but Des at least loved a wide variety of past and present records, and his son grew up hugely influenced by not just Elvis, but also The Beatles and Coldplay, not forgetting a smattering of Fleetwood Mac and the peerless Shine On You Crazy Diamond by Pink Floyd, the epic tribute to the band's original leader, Syd Barrett. Harry was able to practice his inner rock star with the help of a karaoke machine his grandpa Brian had bought him for Christmas. Harry remained particularly close to Brian over the years, describing the man who picked him up and told him to be brave when he fell over and scraped his knee as the coolest guy ever. The admiration was mutual. Recalling his grandson as a small boy, Brian observed that he always had a smile on his face. The famous smile left Harry completely, however, one dreadful evening when he was 7 and his parents sat him and Gemma down in the lounge and told them gently that they were splitting up. Everyone was in tears. Des later recalled, movingly, "It was the worst day of my life. Harry wasn't a crybaby or generally emotional, but he cried then." Although Des and Anne had agreed to separate, he didn't move out immediately, which perhaps made the situation a little easier for their children. There was even a memorable family summer holiday to Cyprus, when Harry, according to both his father and his sister, became the mascot of the teenage girls at the resort hotel. While Gemma was a bit of a loner, Harry was the centre of attention around the pool, entertaining everyone with his now trademark cheeky grin and boisterous nature. To Des's astonishment, when it came for them to leave on the shuttle bus to the airport, a crowd of young women gathered to wave goodbye to his young son. "Bye, Harry, we love you!" they shouted as the bus sped away. "He's very charming," said Des, simply. Eventually, and inevitably, Des moved out of the family home and the divorce was finalised. He still saw the children every couple of weeks, doing his best to make sure everything was all right with both of them, supporting them financially and, when he could, with any emotional problems. Des was not a million miles away, moving to the outskirts of Manchester. "I'm not an estranged dad," he said, and he wasn't, as would prove to be very much the case in the future. He was always close enough to take his son to football or buy him a club jersey or two for the bedroom wall. Anne, meanwhile, met someone, a man who really would become estranged from them in the future. In this case, a future stepfather. John Cox was the good-looking landlord of the Red Lion pub in Pickmere, a village 20 minutes drive past the town of Northwich. Anne was a vivaciously attractive woman of 33 when they met, although they didn't start going out until they had known each other for a year. They were soon making plans for a life together, setting a wedding date for April 2003, not long after Harry's 9th birthday.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.